And we begin this hour with breaking news in relation to the government's desperate attempts to have the immigration detainee known as NZYQ sent to another country. That's prior to the High Court's ruling earlier this month. This comes ahead of the release of the High Court's reasoning for its decision. That will be made public later today. Andrew Clennell has the exclusive details. He joins me now in the studio. Andrew, what can you tell us about this attempt?
Sky News can reveal Home Affairs Minister Clare O'Neill and Immigration Minister Andrew Giles signed off in August on desperate attempts to have the child sex criminal detainee NZYQ sent to another country in a bid to end the High Court case, which this month led to the release of 141 criminal detainees. The revelations in emails filed to the High Court again call into question the government's delay earlier this month in reacting to the High Court decision and Ms O'Neill's statement to Sunday Agenda on Sky News on November 19 that the government had advice that it was, quote, likely to win, unquote, the High Court case. An email from Home Affairs Principal Legal Officer Paul Wiley to Border Force officials dated August 30 says, quote, just on another front, we got the below part summary of a meeting held yesterday between Minister O'Neill, David Gavin, Acting First Assistant Secretary, and Claire Sharp, Group Manager Legal. The action listed on the email was Home Affairs to provide an informal document followed by a written submission to the Minister with redacted views on the prospects of third country settlement. Another email filed to the court from an advisor to Minister Giles, Alice Smith, dated Saturday, September 16, and sent to the now acting head of the Department of Home Affairs, Stephanie Foster, said, quote, closing the loop from the conversation on Thursday morning, Minister Giles is comfortable with high-level approaches being made to Five Eyes partners to seek a third country resettlement option. An affidavit to the court from David Gavin, the acting First Assistant Secretary of Home Affairs, says, quote, the Minister for Home Affairs, Minister O'Neill, and the Minister for Immigration, Minister Giles, approved approaches being made to the US in relation to the plaintiff's removal. On 29th of August, my colleague Claire Sharp and I attended a virtual legal briefing with Minister O'Neill. The plaintiff's case was discussed at this meeting. The Minister indicated she wished for the department to progress all avenues in the plaintiff's case, including approaching the US, UK, Canada and New Zealand, the Five Eyes countries, to get rid of this detainee. On 12th of September 2023, I sent an email to Alice Smith, the senior advisor to Minister Giles and Anne Clark, and in Minister O'Neill's office. In that email, I indicated the department was preparing to approach officials from the Five Eye countries to determine the possibility of resettling the plaintiff. Then details 14th of September, a virtual meeting with Minister Giles' advisor, Ms Smith. Ms Smith was asked whether Minister Giles was comfortable with high-level approaches being made to Five Eyes countries. On 16th of September, Ms Smith emailed me saying Minister Giles was comfortable with this. On 26th of September, I emailed various officers in the department involved in the plaintiff's case, confirming that both Minister O'Neill and Minister Giles were comfortable with approaching the Five Eyes countries based on the meeting of 29 August and the email of 16 September. The approach to Five Eyes countries came after futile attempts to resettle the detainee in Bangladesh and Saudi Arabia as the government worked to try to find a way out of the High Court case. Now, Sky News revealed yesterday the Australian government were desperately attempting through its US embassy while Anthony Albanese was on his state dinner visit to the US last month to get the US State Department to agree to have the child sex criminal detainee NZYQ resettled in the US. Other correspondence revealed by Sky News from the High Court showed an email from David Gavin, September 1, 2023, that said, quote, the Minister for Home Affairs views the case of the utmost importance and wishes all avenues progressed. No stone should be left unturned, would be an apt summary. That was 3 days after this meeting we've just revealed between Minister O'Neill and officials. Minister O'Neill told Sunday Agenda 9 days ago that the government had been advised it was likely to win the case. You knew this could happen in June, though, didn't you, or did you?
We knew that there was a High Court action on foot. We knew that it was 20 years of legal precedent, and we were advised that it was likely that the Commonwealth would win the case, that is, allow us to do what we wanted to do, which is keep these people in detention.
Minister, who advised you you were likely to win, and how recently did you receive that advice?
Well, we received that advice from the Department of Home Affairs, who tell us what chances we have of success and failure in each legal case. But I do need you to understand
that... When did you receive that advice?
That I do need you to understand that our department is one of the most litigated against departments of the Commonwealth.
So Clare O'Neill, the Home Affairs Minister, she says the department told her she was likely to win. They lost in November, had to release these 141 detainees in August. She and Minister Giles are approving, desperately trying to find another home for the detainee the whole case is based on. So Clare O'Neill in that interview declined to say when that advice was received, they were likely to win. And yesterday she gave us this statement saying, in the comments I made on Sunday Agenda, I was referring to operational advice from my department, which detailed efforts to remove the individual in this case from Australia. This would have meant the case wouldn't have been able to proceed. I was not referring to legal advice. And we've been preparing for the loss for some time. But it seems pretty contradictory to me, Tom. We know this afternoon we get the full reasons for this decision. Mm. Will the House have to sit next week to get preventative detention legislation through? Will we see at least some of these detainees detained again, but through applications to courts?
Yeah, so those reasons will sort of give an indication of how many more might be eligible. And I guess the key thing there for the minister, you know, you mentioned the explanation for those comments and supposedly it wasn't about legal advice, but clearly the question remains, there was a lot going on to try to stop it going ahead, the case, or circumvent it, but what was going on to assume it was actually a loss? And yes, maybe you say this sort of call for a release without reasons first might have taken the government by surprise, but why take that risk?
Yeah, I mean, they should have had a plan. There's no doubt about it. And they, after Peter Dutton shamed them into it, they come up with their ankle bracelets and so forth. But these are a ton of emails of officials desperately working, including with the US State Department, to try and get rid of this guy. I mean, it seems pretty evident the minister had ample warning.
Might have been ambitious that the US would take him, but I guess you've got to try.
Well, if they had just released this one individual and dumped the case and kept an eye on him, they wouldn't have had to release the other 141. The precedent wouldn't have been set. It might have been set at some time in the future, but that's
that
the reality.
It takes a while, doesn't it? The High Court doesn't suddenly turn another case around in a few weeks. Andrew, thank you.